The greatest goal, really, that God has for us is that each day we become a little more like Jesus. Amen. That's what He wants for us than we were the previous day. That is God's heart toward us, as Paul made so clear in Romans chapter 8. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to become conformed to the image of His Son, so that He would be the firstborn among many brethren. God has one great comprehensive purpose for each of us, and that is that when the moment arrives and you and I find ourselves standing in the presence of God Almighty, the Ancient of Days, Almighty God, when we stand there, that He will be able to say about us, He'll be able to say, "Welcome, child of mine. It pleases me to see that you look so much like my beloved Son." Kindness is part of the character of God, and if we were ever to hope to be like Jesus, then kindness must become a part of your thoughts and your behavior. It has to be. We have only to look in the Word of God to find abundant examples of kindness. You remember how Ruth chose to care for her mother-in-law, Naomi, after the untimely death of her father-in-law and her own husband? Ruth didn't have to remain with Naomi. She could have easily have gone back to her homeland with her sister, Orpah. They were from a wealthy, aristocratic family. They would have been, everybody would love to have married these ladies. But Ruth stayed. She chose kindness. When Naomi was bitter and wallowing in her grief, Ruth was kind and compassionate. When they needed food, Ruth, who was a princess, really, went to the fields to glean among the servants of Boaz. In other words, she went to pick up what everybody else was, just what was left behind. In other words, they'd already come and got the best of everything. And the princess, literally a princess, aristocratic princess, went to the fields after everyone else and picked up what she could find to feed them. Notice what Boaz said about Ruth. Then he said, "May you be blessed of the Lord, my daughter. You have shown your last kindness to be better than the first by not going after young men, whether poor or rich." In 2 Samuel, you're shown the kindness of David to a crippled son of Jonathan. You remember after many battles that David had won, he returned home and I guess sitting on his throne one morning, he got to thinking about his very best friend, Jonathan. And David asked his servant Ziba, he said, "Is there anyone left of Saul's family to whom I can show kindness?" Ziba answered, "Well, yeah, there's still a son of Jonathan, but he's crippled in both feet." You know, in other words, we want to hide him. He's not perfect. And Mephibosheth was the forgotten prince, a descendant of Israel's first king, who lived a very modest life that was actually heir to great wealth and great prestige. By the time that David was established a king, with all the duties and responsibilities that go along with that office, David, a man after God's own heart, instead of getting caught up with the affairs of the nation, what he ended up doing one morning, he said, he was just wondering, "I would like to show kindness to someone. Is there anyone I can show kindness to today? And I really want to show kindness to anybody who was a part of my covenant friend that I had a covenant with Jonathan. Is there anybody there?" And when he learned, of course, that Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth, was still alive, he brought him to Jerusalem, and this is what he said to him in 2 Samuel. David said to him, "Do not fear, for I will surely show kindness to you for the sake of your father, Jonathan, And I will restore to you all the land of your grandfather Saul, and you'll eat at my table regularly. Church, you do realize that all that David had to do, if you wanted to be kind, was to give him a nice house and give him a servant. That's all he had to do. And that would still be kind. But David did more than that. He got himself personally involved in this man's life. Every day, the crippled prince was brought to the king's table and actually sat at the king's table and ate the king's food. David generously gave back to Mephibosheth all the lands, all the property. This is amazing. Of his grandfather, assigned a manager over it to administer the prince's property wisely. In other words, David gave him part of the kingdom. He gave him the kingdom that Saul had. Saul was the first king. So he gave a lot to this young boy. Why did David do it? Because he wanted to show kindness. And because David was a man who kept promises. How are you? Can you think of promises you hadn't kept? Years before, David and Jonathan had made covenant with each other. Part of the covenant included these words from Jonathan to David in 1 Samuel. You shall not cut off your loving kindness from my house forever, not even when the Lord cuts off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, may the Lord require it at the hand of David's enemies. Are you aware, church, that having a kind heart actually nurtures your physical and mental health? A lot of people don't know that, but it's been proven scientifically that if you have a kind heart, it will nurture your physical and your mental health. That's a proven fact. Medical science has also discovered that people with a kind heart and attitude are healthier and they live longer. They've proven also that an attitude of kindness, that it can decrease blood pressure and minimize stress levels in a person's body. Kindness enhances relationships and nurses peace of mind. And kindness is not just about how you treat other people. It includes how you treat yourself. Some of us are good at forgiving others, but we rarely forgive ourselves. I mean, who do we think we are? You know, there's, you can, you know, carry big Bibles and carry on, and then you won't even forgive yourself, and yet God has already forgiven you. How dare we hold on to it? You know, it's hard to do, but we can do it. I'll tell you why it's hard, because of pride. But we'll get to that. We see others as easy to forgive, but then hold ourselves to unrealistic expectations. Why do we do that? Because we become reliant on our own works to determine whether we're a good person or not in our own eyes. Consciously or subconsciously, we have this crazy expectation of being perfect. And we want to appear perfect before others. Y'all, there's no one perfect in this room. Right. Except the Lord Jesus Christ. And He is here. Yeah. If you cannot be kind to yourself, but are in the habit of verbally beating yourself up, let today be the day that you stop it. That's a commandment. Most of us wouldn't talk to our neighbor the way you talk to yourself. Church, pride makes no room for kindness. Now, most of the time, it's easy to be kind to our friends. You notice it said most of the time. But the Bible calls us to be kind to our enemies. That's a different challenge all the way around. But just because it's challenging doesn't mean that you get a free pass about the whole thing. Jesus said in Luke 6, you know, Jesus can tell it straight, can't he? Treat others the same way you want them to treat you. Oh, we know this scripture. Well, why don't we do it? Treat others the same way you want them to treat you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners in order to receive back the same amount. But love your enemies, do good, and lend expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great. And you will be sons of the Most High. For He Himself is kind to ungrateful and evil men. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Now, why is kindness so powerful? Because kindness is at the heart of who God Almighty really is. David said of the Lord in 2 Samuel, with the kind you show yourself kind, with the blameless you show yourself blameless. And then in Psalms 145, the Lord is righteous in all His ways and kind in all His deeds. Proverbs 21. Whoever pursues righteousness and kindness will find life, righteousness, and honor. Paul even opened his comments on love with love is patient and kind. You know, church, walking in love requires walking in kindness. But where there is no kindness, there really is no love. Let me give you a few nuggets before we close about kindness. Kindness is the language which the deaf can hear, and the blind, they can see it. One act of kindness can sometimes be the catalyst to change a person's life. Always choose a little kindness. Always. Always choose to be a little kinder than necessary. Be kind whenever possible. It's always possible. In his first letter, Paul wrote this, 1 Peter. Like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation, if you've tasted the kindness of the Lord. Colossians 3. Since God chose you to be the holy people He loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. So, when all is said and done, kindness is about loving people more than they deserve. For that is exactly how God is kind toward us.